Value-free science. This is a slogan that's seen often. So what do you think? Is science value-free? Well, my spontaneous answer was yes. Of course science is value-free. As scientists, we need to be objective. We can't let our research be guided by any kind of subjective values or belief systems. Or at least that's what we should strive for. But the more I thought about it, the more I questioned if this value-free ideal of science was realistic. So I asked someone who knows much more about the topic than myself. Heather Douglas is a philosopher and a leading expert on the role of values in science.
One of the central ideas that drove the value-free ideal is this idea that scientists are not responsible for the impact of their work on society, that it is, for example, policymakers or other actors who are to mediate that impact. And this really became attractive to scientists after the end of World War II with the atomic bomb explosion. Scientists did not want to be held responsible for the uses of their work. So the whole idea that science should be independent from politics, that it should function outside of societal influence, that social and ethical values have no legitimate role to play in scientific practices or scientific inference, that really got cemented during this sort of late mid 20th century period.
Honestly, it took me a while to swallow this. If you really believe in this concept of science being value-free and totally independent from everything, it also means that science is separated from the rest of society. Because if you aren't committed to any values, you're not responsible for anything. And is that something we really want? Personally, I don't think so. I'm a scientist, but I'm also part of society. And as members of society, we have all kinds of responsibilities and values, religious and political values, for example. Our values are constantly guiding our actions in everyday life because they mark what is important to us and they make us feel responsible for certain things. For instance, I try to support local businesses when possible by shopping from them or getting a coffee from a local cafe instead of a big chain. I try to be environmentally conscious by reducing my consumption of single-use products. Sometimes it's easy to name one's own values. But some values are so hidden deeply in our culture and education that we simply believe that those values are right. And if someone who doesn't follow our values, they're wrong. Clearly, this type of thinking is a source of conflict, and it's dangerous for every scientific inquiry. So, I asked Heather how we should handle our values whilst we're doing our research.
There are different moments of scientific practice, and those different moments utilize and should utilize social and ethical values differently. So, judgments about what to pursue, which projects are interesting or important, are of course value-directed. Which kinds of methodologies are acceptable ethically and socially are, of course, value-directed. But deciding what counts as sufficient evidential justification shouldn't be value-directed. It should just be merely value-influenced in what I've called an indirect way, because assessments of what counts as sufficient evidence is about what kind of uncertainty we're willing to tolerate. And social and ethical values help us assess what counts as acceptable uncertainty, but shouldn't override the presence or absence of evidence per se.
What Heather means is that if you're choosing your research topics based on your interest in maintaining the environment, that's okay. Or if you want to contribute with your research to reaching the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, not a problem. You don't always have to save the world. You can go for a project that might give you a career boost if that's where values lie. No judgment from my side. Your personal values may come in here, but as long as you stay within a very broad frame of basic human values, that's fine. But once you've started your actual research, any type of personal values should be left aside. But even then, you're not entering a value-free space.
There's no space in science that is fully devoid of social and ethical values, but there becomes a point when the ethical and social values become about how much evidence is enough to continue a trial, to continue with the methodology, to say that the experiment is not yet done enough, or it is done enough. So that sort of judgment is continually inflected with social and ethical values throughout scientific practice. But that doesn't mean that the social and ethical values should, as I've called, determine the choice by themselves, because it's about evidential sufficiency. It's the combination of the evidence and the values, and the values shouldn't override the evidence. So you shouldn't use the value by itself to say, like, I don't really like the result, I'm going to throw out this evidence. That's where things go horribly wrong.
While you might use your values and interests as a guidance for the choice of a research question, you do still need to strictly follow scientific principles in the actual process of research when you choose your methodology and when you analyze and interpret your results. Otherwise, you're simply not doing science. But most of you already follow scientific principles without even actively thinking about it. But sometimes one can run into situations in which it can be helpful to make those ethical principles explicit. You might, for example, realize that if you delete a few data points from your sample, then the correlation you're looking for would be significant. Or you might hear a colleague's presentation on a topic on which you also work on, and it may seem very tempting to take over their ideas into your own paper. In those cases, you might find some guidance in the Code of Conduct for Research Integrity that most national and international research organizations have published. You can find some of them on our homepage. Let's not forget that research is a social enterprise. Maintaining standards of scientific integrity is a shared task. One bad apple can spoil the bunch, tainting the reputation of researchers in the general public and undermining trust in science. If you suspect one of your colleagues of scientific misconduct, you should contact the Ombudsperson for the Scientific Integrity at your institute or at your research organization. If you don't have that position in your country, get the support of your peers and demand that a position like that should be installed and become active.